Well, happy Thursday, Fellowship Church, and anyone else who's watching in. My name is Mark. I'm one of the pastors here at Fellowship Church, and we're in day four of our walk through James chapter one of daily devotionals. And in this passage, first, let me just encourage you, push pause, go get your Bible, or open up your Bible on the computer. Really, it's essential that we look at what we are talking about here. And, or at least it's helpful. Okay, so James chapter 1, verses 12 through 15 today. Verse 12 goes like this. Blessed is the man who remains steadfast under trial. For when he has stood the test, he will receive the crown of life, which God has promised to those who love him. Let no one say when he is tempted, I am being tempted by God. For God cannot be tempted with evil, and he himself tempts no one. But each person is tempted when he is lured and enticed by his own desire. And when desire has conceived, it brings forth sin. And sin, when it is fully grown, brings forth death. Okay, so in these verses, we see basically two things. We're told to remain steadfast under trial, and we're told kind of the source of sin, which helps us know how to attack sin and put it away. And so first we're told, remain steadfast. Blessed is the man who remains steadfast under trial. And this word steadfast, we've seen it before, right? Back in verse 3, when we were told, count it all joy when you meet trials of various kinds, for you know that the testing of your faith produces what? Steadfastness. All right, and now we're told, blessed is the man who remains steadfast under those trials. And so steadfastness is a good goal, just to hang in, to endure, to persevere in being faithful and patient and joyful even amidst trials. To just make it our goal, hey, God, help me to be steadfast in living in a way that pleases you today. But how is the person who's just remaining steadfast, how is that person blessed? And there in verse 12 and 13, you see that, or verse 12, it tells us that the blessing we receive is a future blessing. And we experience it presently because of the hope and the promise of the future blessing. But here's the blessing. Blessed is the man who remains steadfast under trial. For, here's why, he will receive the crown of life, which God has prepared for those who love him. It's a future blessing. So remain steadfast now, and there is an awesome blessing coming. It's kind of like the Olympic athlete who's training for the Olympics, and it's arduous, it's a trial, it's a struggle every day, lots of hours of work by himself or by herself, eating very carefully, no glory involved, but they're looking forward to competing on a global stage in the Olympics. They're looking forward to the possibility of a gold medal and the glory that comes with that. And James tells us, if you remain steadfast as a Christian under trial and keep trusting in God and keep trying to live in a way that's pleasing to him, you will receive, it's not, you might get a gold medal, you will receive the crown of life from God, which God has promised to all those, to everybody who loves him. And the crown of life is basically life, eternal life. Eternal life, which comes with a resurrected body, which comes in the new heavens and new earth, which comes in a world where there's no sin, in a world where there's no deadly viruses, in a world where there are no tears, in a world where most importantly there is Jesus in our presence forever. And so we're told, stay steadfast now because of your future hope. In 1 Peter chapter 1, we're told, set your hope fully, completely, all of your hope, set all of your hope fully on the grace that is to be revealed at the coming of Jesus Christ. And so, Christian, you have a hope in Christ. And if you're not a Christian, you can have a hope that's sure, that's rock solid, that's foundational, and that can make you feel blessed, whatever's going on, because you know where all of this thing is headed, and you know it's going to end in the crown of life, eternal life, being experienced by you with God and God's people forever. And so you're blessed. So remain steadfast and you'll feel blessed as you look forward to your future hope. The second thing is he then talks about sin. And let no one say when he's tempted, you know, I'm being tempted by God. So one of the things that comes with trials is temptation. And so maybe your work has taken a break, your daily schedule has taken a break, school's taken a break, a lot of our church schedule has taken a break. But you know what hasn't taken a break? Temptation, sin. And at the end of this passage in verse 15, we're told, you know, sin brings forth death. It brings all kinds of destruction into our lives. And so sin doesn't take time off. Since sin doesn't take time off, we have to pay attention to it. Maybe you're seeing sin come out of yourself, come out in your home. So how do we deal with it? Well, James kind of gives us an idea that we can deal with it at, we can trace it to its source. And first, remember, sin doesn't come from God. We're not sinning because God's letting us down or because God's allowing trials. And so we need to not blame God when we end up sinning. And so that's pretty clear. God isn't tempted with evil and he himself tempts no one. But then we're told that sin comes from our desires, from the desires that we have. And when our desires, kind of when we're lured and enticed by our own desires, and it's implied selfish desires, that brings forth sin. In James chapter 4, we're told, where do fights and quarrels come from among you? Don't they come from this? You know, the fact that you desire and cannot have, and so you murder. You know, you want something and don't have it, and so you fight and you quarrel. And so here's just a tip, I think, for us as we're trying to be steadfast, is when we see sin come out, just trace it back to the desires. What am I wanting here? What am I wanting that I'm not getting? Maybe I'm wanting comfort. Maybe I'm wanting security. Maybe I'm wanting people to just leave me alone. Maybe I'm wanting to know how to do things that I don't know how to do. You know, I don't know. There's all kinds of desires. Maybe I'm just wanting pleasure. Maybe I'm wanting to escape. But trace those things back to the desires and then ask God to do a work at, I need to ask God to do a work at like the desire level in my heart. And he will. He'll help us because he's a God who doesn't tempt us, who's always available to help us as we try to remain steadfast. So that's the word for today. Look at the next paragraph for tomorrow. And those who are trying to memorize this passage, keep it up. And I think God, the Holy Spirit will bless you as you put his word in your heart. A couple pastoral words. First, our online prayer meeting was last night, and that's still up on our Facebook page if you want to watch that and pray along with us. Later. God hears all the prayers, not just at 6 o'clock on Wednesday nights. Second thing is, thank you. So many of you have written emails or Facebook posts or commented under the Sunday service just with encouragement and telling me and the other pastors and elders that you're praying for us. And so thank you. There's been so much encouragement that I haven't been able to respond to everything, but just know that I'm reading those. And I've seen the emails, and so thank you. And I'm sorry if I haven't been able to reply directly to you yet. All right, God bless you, and we'll be back on Friday for the next paragraph.